Jenny Moore is the Director of Sustainable Development and Environmental Stewardship at the British Columbia Institute of Technology. She works with faculty and staff to advance BCIT's leadership in sustainability education and applied research. I think I'm going to go off script here because Jenny's one of our ecological footprinting heroes in Vancouver. She has actually looked at the ecological footprinting, has finished her PhD under Bill Rees, and has looked at the ecological footprint of Vancouver, and her slides are going to be fantastic. So, Jenny, I'm really excited you're here with us. Jim, how do I introduce Jim Boothroyd? He's a great dancer. Jim is the co-author of the Project Green Block. And really, I think, imagine Jim knocking on all of his neighbors' doors. Who's here from Green Block? Do we have any neighbors from Green Block? Okay, because they're all at work.
They're fed up hearing me.
Yeah, they're sick of hearing. He goes knocking on all their doors and say, hey, what do you think about becoming one of the first neighborhoods to track our ecological footprint? I think he neglected to say that's going to take a month of you recording everything you do for a month every day. And then we're going to figure out how we can reduce our ecological footprint. And Helen, where's Helen? I saw you here. Helen Mannion from Evergreen is going to help us along. And the Evergreen Foundation has been one of their key partners. Well, Jim comes by this work, honestly, I think. Jim used to be with David Suzuki Foundation. He has worked on sustainability for many, many years, and he's worked on communications in a whole range of different, working globally and locally on AIDS issues. And I met Jim many years ago when he worked with us at the Institute for Media Policy and Civil Society Impacts, and he is his own force of nature. So I would not want to be in the neighborhood when Jim came knocking if I didn't have the energy to support this project, because it would be hell living next to you, I think, if I didn't. So I'm thrilled. Jenny and Jim, take it away, and then we'll head into the dialogue.
Okay, great. So I think
I have to give you this, so those in the web world,
no, I don't need that.
No, we need you.
No, I have it.
Oh, you've got it.
So I don't know how to turn it off. Okay. All right, so thank you very much for having us here today. It's a real pleasure to be here. So my I'm basically going to introduce you to the concept of one planet living, based on my research for my PhD that looked at the City of Vancouver's ecological footprint. And so the City of Vancouver has a reputation for being a leader in sustainability, but unfortunately our consumption metrics are pretty much on par with some of the highest consumers around the world. So we may be leaders in North America, but North America is a high consuming society generally, and so we're leaders of the highest consuming maybe in a sustainable world, but if everyone followed the Vancouver model to sustainability, we certainly wouldn't get there. And even city staff are aware that, you know, they are really dedicated to this issue, but they're aware that we still have a long, long way to go, despite the progress. So there's a bit of a schism here between how we're perceiving sustainability and what's really required. And my research tried to delve into that, just understanding what is that gap. So before I talk about the ecological footprint, I wanted to talk, since we're at Carbon Talks, about our carbon footprint. So probably I would say the correct way to talk about an emissions metric of tons CO2e, the equivalence of carbon, which is about 80% of our greenhouse gas emissions are carbon dioxide, but there's other sources of emissions like methane, nitrous oxides as well, that have higher global warming potential. And so tons CO2e equivalent, which probably many of you are aware, is taking all of those emissions and averaging them out to be equivalent to one ton of carbon dioxide. And the City of Vancouver measures its carbon footprint. They call it carbon footprint. I call it an emission inventory, and I'll explain that in a minute why. To be 4.9 tons of carbon dioxide equivalent per capita. So you see the total number. And if we actually looked at what they're measuring, they're only measuring transportation, buildings, and waste, because that's the way the protocol works for municipal governments. That's what they look at. But if we use a consumption-based approach, where we actually look at all the things that we're consuming to support our lifestyle, the number almost doubles to 9.2 tons CO2e per capita. And that's including the emissions associated with food production and transportation, as well as consumables. So it almost doubles when you include a bigger roster of impacts from our lifestyle behavior. Now, the reason why I was calling that a greenhouse gas emission inventory and not the carbon footprint is because the original concept of the ecological footprint includes what was originally considered to be a carbon footprint, which is a measure of area. Okay, a footprint is a measure of area. And the energy land associated with sequestration of carbon dioxide emissions is actually originally the true carbon footprint metric. As we became more aware of the urgency to deal with greenhouse gas emissions, a quick political turn of phrase became, what's our carbon footprint? And in fact, that concept now has, or that terminology, has eclipsed the original concept of the ecological footprint and become a common mode of parlance. But the original is that a footprint is a metric of area based on the amount of land needed to sequester carbon dioxide emissions. Okay, so that's the way I'm going to start using that term for the rest of this presentation. So an ecological footprint, then, is the carbon footprint plus the footprints of land areas required to produce the resources or materials we need to sustain our lifestyle. So it includes things like forest land from which we extract timber products for furniture or paper, the energy land, which I mentioned, which is forest land, which is dedicated exclusively to the sequestration of carbon dioxide emissions. And another nuance is it's only carbon dioxide emissions. I mentioned earlier the carbon equivalent. In ecological footprinting, we don't count methane or nitrous oxides or pentahexafluorides or whatever they're called. We only count carbon, and that's because nature can only sequester carbon emissions, carbon dioxide emissions. It cannot sequester methane. Methane has to break down in the atmosphere over 500 years until it gets back into its original elements of carbon dioxide, which can be sequestered. And the footprint is counting our demand on nature services on a one-year basis. And so we're only looking at how much carbon dioxide is sequestered by the oceans and terrestrial land areas in the 1 year. Anything above that is still contributing to climate forcing above what nature can absorb. Okay, so the message here is that the ecological footprint is not the only metric we should be looking at. It's one way to look at our demand on nature services. The value, though, is it does give us a way to compare what nature is able to produce or regenerate in a year and what we're demanding. So we can look at our demand relative to a sustainable or ecologically sustainable threshold. Okay, everybody with me? Okay, so back to energy land I just explained, exclusive land just for carbon sequestration, so we wouldn't be cutting down those trees. Grazing land is the land that we use for fodder for our animals. It's usually more marginal. Cropland is land that's highly fertile that we're using to produce our crops, like grains, oats, rice, things like that, as well as some of our fibers, like cotton fiber. And, of course, we do actually subsidize a lot of our cropland we use for animal feed as well, right? Hay and corn. Urban land typically is cropland that's been appropriated for the built environment of our cities, right? So the building, the city footprint, built environment footprint. And we consider it the same fertility or loss of potential fertility as cropland because typically cities evolved in places that were agriculturally fertile. That's how our cities evolved. But not all cities are, you know, in the desert, the built land isn't appropriating the cropland potential. And then fishing area, or fishing land, should probably be fishing area, is that fertile area of benchlands from which we're actually extracting fish proteins. So the aquatic environment, when I say benchlands, meaning the 200-mile limit off the coast. It's usually where we're getting most of that seafood from. So coupling all of that together is our ecological footprint. And if we're living within one planet living means that we're living within the means of nature to regenerate all of these resources and to sequester our carbon dioxide emissions within a one-year balance. We're not overdrafting or over-demanding. Now, in Vancouver, this data is based on an urban metabolism study that I did for my PhD research of Vancouver. This is all the things that are passing through Vancouver for consumption reflected back as our demand on nature's availability or resources. It's quite big, and here you see this is what nature can supply on an annual basis. So you see it's cropland, grazing land, water and forest. There's two additional land types. That's the energy land, the big orange, and then the urban, the built area footprint. And so our demand is much, much higher than what's available. And that is our sustainability gap. So if we were living at One Planet Living, we'd be on par with the world biocapacity, or maybe even slightly less if we wanted to save some room for nature. This is the same data as that tall bar that I showed you, reflected back in a different way. Instead of by land type, now I'm showing you how that land type is reflected by the activities. So food is tremendous in terms of our demand for nature services, followed by transportation, buildings, consumables, and water is very small. And that's because what the footprint's looking at is only the energy associated with the treatment and conveyance of the water, not the water itself. By volume, water is the biggest mass moving through the city. Now I'm going to drill down into each one of those components just to give you a sense of what's driving the footprint. This is food. Remember, it was half of the total footprint. Now within food, the land required for crop production is the dominant driver, followed by the embodied energy in things like fertilizers, pesticides, farm machinery equipment, that kind of thing. And what's interesting is pasture land is small. So remember, now what we're looking at is not, we're looking at the equivalent bioproductive capacity of nature, represented as what's called a global hectare. Okay? So we might have a large range of pasture land that we're demanding, but its fertility or its bioproductivity capacity is very small relative. Like you could have 50 hectares of marginal grazing land or 1 hectare of cropland, and the 1 hectare can actually produce more from a biological productivity perspective. What's interesting in this graph is that of this big massive blue area, cropland, half of it is cropland that's being diverted to animal feed. And so this is the same data reflected by the types of foods we're demanding. So what the previous one was, you know, food by materials, embodied energy, et cetera. Same data now going back into allocation by the types of foods. And so here we see that fish, meat, and eggs is the majority of it. And of that, this, most of it is red meat. Most of that red pie chart, about 67% of it is just red meat. So when you're looking at what kinds of food impacts, you can see that red meat is major. One thing I didn't point out here is the operating energy, which is food miles, is almost insignificant. And we, as society, we tend to focus a lot on food miles, but it's from an ecological footprint perspective, it's really how we're using our cropland. Now I'm going to look at the buildings. So people who've done a lot of energy modeling within cities, this isn't going to be a surprise to them. Most of the energy demand is in the operation of our buildings, equally split between commercial and residential buildings. A much smaller component is dedicated to the embodied energy in the built environment itself. And for consumables, now I'm in the next going around that graph. In consumables, what's interesting here is that the materials disposed, that's the blue, that's the products that we touch in our life, the piece of paper that you're holding, the cup that you're drinking from. The light blue and the dark red are the embodied materials and energy in the supply chain that went into manufacturing those products before you ever came in contact with them. The pink is only the energy associated with the remanufacture, recycling of those products. And that's because in ecological footprinting, if we're reintroducing a product back, we don't count the land twice. But there's energy associated with remanufacturing it, so we're recycling it. And the green and the orange is actually the ecological footprint associated with operating our solid waste and liquid waste facilities. So the message here is that to get to One Planet Living, we really have to reduce the consumption of a product in the beginning. Improvement of our waste, reducing greenhouse gas emissions from our landfills, for example, the green, is not going to get us to sustainability. It's actually changing the supply chain manufacturing processes and consuming less is what we need to be thinking about. And here's transportation. So again, no surprise to people working in the sector that the energy associated with operation of private vehicles is half of that transportation footprint, followed by air travel and the embodied energy of the vehicles. And bear in mind that in the ecological footprint metric, we're actually using underestimates. We're trying to be conservative. We're trying to be as accurate as we can with the data that we can include. But always, you're probably erring on the side of conservation. So I've been told, for example, that the air travel data could very well be double what my estimate is. It doesn't include the embodied energy of the planes themselves, for example. The embodied energy that you see there, that's just for the motor vehicles. So getting to One Planet Living, really we're going to have to look at how much private vehicle usage we have, how many vehicles are on the road, and look at how small public transit is, and even commercial transportation. So to get to one planet living, for us, the biggest thing is we have to work with senior levels of government in order to change the regulations around those supply chain manufacturing products. But for individuals, making most of your trips, 86% by walking, cycling, and transit, only very rarely using a car and not owning a car, and that car should be zero emissions if you are going to drive it. Reducing food waste post-purchase. So that means if you buy it, eat it. Don't let it rot in the fridge. Don't let it get freezer burned. Don't overcook for a potluck and have that food go wasted. It's a really big, important piece of the footprint. Reducing red meat consumption and substituting. So you don't have to go without. You just substitute. You choose white proteins instead, or legumes, or green vegetables. Improving energy efficiency across the entire building stock by 40%. We think we have got that one well in hand. The City of Vancouver's new bylaw for net zero buildings by 2020 is moving in the right direction around that, and we can do a lot more. We know how to build energy efficient buildings. We just have to get on with doing it. And then reducing paper consumption by 50%. Now, interestingly enough, paper, it's because of the way the footprint works. We look at the land area associated with production of the fibers, the wood fibers. So it biases towards consumable products that are land-based. That doesn't mean that production or recycling of your computers is better than using paper per se. I just don't have the ability to measure that. Part of the reason is that there is not good evidence around how we manage hazardous materials and what happens with the disposal of some of the toxic materials. So definitely, if you want to get to one planet living, don't just recycle your paper, because we already do recycle 70% of our paper. Just don't use it to begin with. But also be mindful that, you know, the smartphone's not a free ride either. So one planet living, what would it look like? We'd probably be repurposing and refixing, sharing our belongings, avoiding consumption of paper, red meat, bottled beverages. Roads, roofs, and walls would all be used for urban agriculture. Most trips would be by walking, cycling, and transit. Most people would not fly or own cars. And buildings would be energy efficient and zero emission, and so would the vehicles. So thank you very much.
Can you hear me? Is that on? It's working? Can I just quickly get a sense of who you are? How many students in this room? How many folks working in the environmental sector? How many people working for businesses downtown, banks, industries? Yeah? Retired folks? Okay. Have I missed anybody? Have I missed anybody? Any big group here? No? Okay, thank you. I beg your pardon. Let's see. There we go. I want to tell you about my neighborhood, where I live. I live at 22nd and Columbia, which is formerly called Riley Park. I live on a block with 36 houses, probably about 50 households. It's what I would describe as an affluent neighborhood, but not the high end in Vancouver, not lower. I'd say it's sort of somewhere in the middle. It's about three blocks into the west side of Vancouver. Detached houses, renters, mostly owners, but renters as well. This is my house. There's a tenant in the basement. Well-connected, as you know, that area is, with a Canada line and all sorts of amenities. Also, a community, a neighborhood with a fairly good coherent community. So 4 years ago, 5 years ago, me and one of my neighbors began applying for these neighborhood small grants that come through the Vancouver Foundation to do little projects to bring bees back into our neighborhood. He installed honeybee hives. I worked with neighbors to build planters in our back lane that would produce flowers that support bees. And we got talking with a number of neighbors, and there was a nucleus of people who were really enthusiastic. And the project Green Block grew out of that initiative, a desire to do something a little bit more ambitious. The Vancouver the City of Vancouver came in with its Greenest City Action Plan. The Vancouver Foundation announced a new grant program called the Greenest City Community Grants. We thought we could apply for one of those. We've got a bigger idea about what we'd like to do with our neighborhood. And so that's what Project Green Block is. The start of this for me was seeing some polling data, some market research that showed that in Canada, it was a big study of sustainability. It hasn't been published, but it basically showed that 66% of Canadians are really concerned about climate change and overconsumption, and yet the vast majority of that group don't know what to do about it. They feel there are a whole number of big barriers. They feel that they're first of all, not quite sure what they should do. They don't feel their neighbors are doing enough. They don't feel governments are doing nearly enough. They despair about just the enormity of the problems associated with climate change and consumption. And so they are kind of paralyzed. And so I've been thinking through these little projects we did in our neighborhood and getting a sense of the enthusiasm and energy that exists on just my block as to whether you can develop a set of tools that can bring together a neighborhood, and I'm thinking very specifically about people who just by happenstance happen to live together, live on the same block, nothing else in common. And by the way, my block is the diverse block. There are pensioners, Asian pensioners, there are airline pilots, inventors, Jewish, Korean, Cantonese, mainly Caucasian, mainly kind of professional, middle class, educated, I'd say, but and then renters, a whole, we have students and a variety of other folks, people who run their own businesses. Can you bring a group of people like that together and develop a set of tools that allow them to work together to reduce their footprint and to basically build a more resilient community? So this grant's also informed by the Alone Together report of the Vancouver Foundation that found that Vancouverites, all of you know about that probably, that Vancouverites very often feel very isolated and that communities are not very well integrated in Vancouver. So the question behind Green Block is, can you develop that toolkit? Can you scale a toolkit like that to other neighborhoods, similar neighborhoods across Vancouver and across Canada? And specifically, we're trying to reduce our ecological footprint by 25% in 3 years. It's an aspirational goal, but that's the aim of this project. So two things, build a more resilient community, two, reduce footprint significantly. So what are the tools? The first thing was a survey of household ecological footprint. I'd heard about Jenny's fascinating research and wanted to see if we could go right down to the household level. She'd done research. She'd done Vancouver's ecological footprint. Could we do this at the household level? I hadn't heard of anything like this. I'd heard of carbon audits and carbon measures of households, but I hadn't heard of an ecological footprint measure. Jenny said, yes, we could do that, and moreover, she'd love to get her hands on the data around food. So she worked with our sponsor, which is Evergreen, and Helen put together an incredible ecological footprint survey drawing on the data that Jenny had produced. And that meant that for at the least 2 weeks to 30 days, households that participated in the survey would have to very carefully scrutinize what they were consuming in the areas of food, building, energy and electricity, air travel, local transportation, and consumables and waste. And for me, I did it for 30 days. I'd spend 20 minutes to 25 minutes every night writing down. The most tedious part was what I ate that day. And so I'd have to break it down by, you know, portions of red meat or fish, cereals, dairy, eggs, stimulants, which are like coffee and things like that, and everything else. And then filed, and you'd do that online, and it would go to Helen, and she'd send you a congratulations note, thank you. But it was tedious, and it was hard work. And 23 households on this block agreed to do it. So first point, we can actually get people are actually interested in doing this. 23 households, and now I should just note that there are probably a total of about 100 households, because we allowed people on the side streets, between 22nd and 23rd, and Columbia and Yukon, that's where I am. We allowed people on the side streets to join in. But most of the people are on the main block here. This prompted conversations immediately, because all of us were struggling to do this survey, and that was the point of the survey, was to give people some quantifiable data with which to work and to provide a baseline for this project that we could then measure against 3 years out to actually see if this neighborhood's made any progress in reducing its footprint. But it was also, on a deep level, trying to get people thinking about their footprints and actually to talk to each other about what they were discovering. And there were lots of conversations like this. We'll come back and tell you a bit more. This is what one of the footprints looks like. I can't tell you who it is. It's the data are confidential. You get, after a month, 6 weeks, Helen sent out files like these for each household. And this is one of them. So this particular household had an average footprint of 3.04 global hectares, and its breakdown in terms of its footprint, you can see over there, food 48%, building 20%, transportation 20%, consumables waste 11%, and that's the number of global hectares for that particular household, everybody in the household, that they would be needed to sequester the carbon and provide the resources for that household to live at the level it does. It would take 1.8 planets, planet Earth, for that household to, if everybody on Earth lived had that sort of lifestyle and level of consumption. There were comparators in here, very valuable ones, and this study, the reason I was interested in having this kind of survey initially was that I'd seen some data from social marketing research that showed that the most powerful lever for norming in the area of water consumption is if you just put a door knocker, you measure people's water consumption, you put a door knocker on their front door and it says you're using this much water, you're 1% above the average for your neighborhood or 2% below the average, and that the people who are over quickly reduce their consumption, and the people who are under are encouraged and they do more. So we have in here a comparator for the neighborhood. So the average for the neighborhood there you can see was the yellow, the second line down, I think it's about 4 something, Helen, is that right?
4.77.
4.7. You remember this household was 3.04, so it's patting itself on the back, feeling really good. And then there's the world, the global average, you can see how, and that's the lowest bar on the list, that's 2.7. And that's the Canadian average, that 7.1. And then we go into the footprint breakdowns. I've got to move through these fairly quickly. We can come back to them later, but you can see that 0.44 global hectares are devoted in this particular household specifically to meat consumption. So it's the biggest area in which they can this household can reduce its consumption, and it tells you what to do. Choose white meat, waste less food. Transportation, similar thing. Breakdown according to vehicles and air travel. Building footprint breakdown, and that's in this household, I think for most of the households on the block, it's natural gas and electricity. Consumables breakdown, and this is that first slide you saw of somebody weighing something. We were all given a household scale, and once every week we would weigh our, we had to weigh our recycling in intimate detail, and every 2 weeks, our trash going to the landfill goes out every 2 weeks. You have to weigh that too. Okay, so tool number one, survey. Tool number two, three dialogues, 3 hours each with a really good meal built into them at a nice location. This first one was at the Hillcrest Community Center, and David Suzuki came to kick it off to encourage everybody. And basically what David Suzuki said was, this is where the action is right now. There's nothing happening, or not very much happening at the global level. There's less happening at the national level. And the provincial level, go elsewhere. So these kind of projects are critical to reducing to getting Canadians really addressing the issue of climate change and hyperconsumption. And we had delicious meals tied into this. This project is meant to be pleasurable. Why? Because whenever you talk to people about sustainability, they get this terrible grinding feeling in their stomach that they're guilty and this is all going to involve sacrifice. So if you go to their stomachs with good food, they come out. And we had between 16 and 23 people, 23 households represented at each of the dialogues. The dialogues, what did they do? One, they gave an opportunity for people to learn more about their household footprints and to discuss ways that they could reduce them. They gave people an opportunity to get to know each other, build trust. And thirdly, they focused their minds on a collective project that they could undertake to reduce the footprint of the neighborhood jointly. So it's all woven together, the notion of community development, but also with a real a concrete element of how are we going to do this together to reduce our footprint by 25%. That's the group at the last dialogue at the end of January, at which three community projects were identified. Maybe I can tell you more about those in the questions and answers afterwards. If you want to know more about this, go to evergreen.ca's webpage about Project Green Block. Check out our Facebook page, Project Green Block. We're going to launch this officially sometime in the spring, probably. So you'll be hearing more about this. Whoops. You'll be hearing more about this through the media. And finally, this is a three-year project. The community, the joint projects that we're undertaking, and I'll just quickly tell you about them. Tear up a street, turn it into an urban farm, and build, plant an orchard, and have a green space where we can actually use as a park. Renewable energy project, some kind of group buying of energy audits and or geothermal installation that people can tap into. And three, a big sharing network that works it could be a hyper Craigslist at our local level, combined with a tool library, tool shed that people can use so they don't have to buy six lawnmowers when they only need one lawnmower for six households. So those are the three projects that different groups coming out of that last dialogue are now advancing. I'm in charge of the one for the street greening urban farm piece, and I had eight people at a meeting last night, and we've divided it up, and there's tremendous enthusiasm for it. So I guess what I want to say, just last thing I'd say, is there's momentum behind this, and so far it's pretty encouraging. Okay, that's it.
Thanks. Wow. It is very exciting. So what we usually do now is open it up to you to question. We're going to pass this around. What I would ask you is try and keep your comment or your question pithy so that we can really get a dialogue going. So who wants to go first? Questions for Jenny, for Jim, comments? Who's going to be first? There we go, the brave soul. If you want to just introduce yourself and fire away.
Hi, I'm Sarah from the School of Community and Regional Planning, master's student there. Thanks for your talk. My question is the people that are not involved. So sounds like you have lots of enthusiasm and lots of people showing up and getting at meetings. But when you're talking about things like tearing up a street, what happens if someone's not interested? And so has it come up and how have you tackled it?
So it hasn't come up yet because we haven't actually put those projects forward, but that is a central question that we're asking as the committee that's working on that particular piece and the other projects. It's going to be a lot of going around and knocking on doors combined with a number of tactics such as Columbia Street. Between 22nd and 23rd, close it down with bollards on one day in a month or two. In the spring, serve food, bring everybody from the neighborhoods around us, because remember, we've just worked with one actual block. We need to go to the block surrounding and bring many people in and just share the ideas about what we're planning to do. And then we're going to have to do some listening, and we're going to have to develop a proposal that's sensitive to local concerns around parking, around mobility, around rats is one of the things that's come up. That's going to be a challenge, and we're going to be working with the city at the same time. So, yeah.
Other questions?
I have a question from Twitter from @Skylab for Jim, and it is, did you encounter any negative reactions to people who were compared with their neighbors?
No, because I think maybe I need to be here. The results are entirely confidential, and the people who, I mean, it's a selective sample. These are all people who want to know a little bit more about their footprints and are fairly open to discussing it and realize the value of some kind of comparators. They want to know where they are in comparison with their neighbors. I would say that in my case, I looked at the footprint, and I could see things in the footprint that could be refined in future. There were certain things that my footprint underestimated, for example. So the comparator was useful, but it also gave me a sense of I'm probably, you know, I had a better idea of where I was probably in the ranking after looking at where I was in relation to others and some of the things that I think that my, for instance, I burn wood in a wood-burning stove that's an insert in the old fireplace. It's a high efficiency burning wood burning thing, but the footprint doesn't capture wood burning. So
or rugs going out the door.
Rugs, yeah, I'll tell you that.
We caught that one.
Yeah. Tell us the rug story in a minute.
You want to pass that along?
My experience when talking to people about, well, I do carbon footprint, but people are usually fairly shocked or have no idea how much carbon they're emitting. Do you find, you know, the people you're talking to underestimate in their own head what their impact is?
Sure. I think that a lot of people, aren't thinking about it from an ecological footprint perspective. But I think we're, certainly when I worked with city staff at Vancouver, where the shock came was how big the food component was. And there's a little bit of a bias in my method because I'm relying heavily on national statistics for the food data because we weren't able to get good local food consumption data, which is part of what a big contribution of the Green Block project will be to refining the analysis. So people were surprised by what was driving their footprint more than how big it was relative. I think people kind of anticipate, we know we're high-end consumers, so I don't think anybody was really under the illusion that we would be at the one planet level. I guess the other big thing is, again, because I was dealing with the cities, the average of the city, not individuals, the nature of the gap, like the size of the gap was a little bit surprising in terms of how challenging it's going to be to reduce the gap. And the other thing is that the city is one of the most important actors in helping us reduce our footprint, but a lot of what needs to happen is at the individual choice level or at the senior government level. So the city is an important actor, but really requires collaboration with the citizenry and with senior governments if we're going to actually achieve the One Planet Living goal.
I wanted to invite Helen to come in. Helen is with Evergreen Foundation and has been kind of the person having to do all of the surveying things. Anything you'd like to add? And then we've got a question up here.
Oh, I don't know if I have anything in particular to say. For me, it was a really interesting experience just to see how motivated this group was to participate in a project like this. I know we definitely had some apprehension before starting out that nobody would want to do the survey, that they would all just be like, nope, there's no way, I don't have time, this is silly, or that nobody would be able to commit to coming out to three dialogues because they wouldn't have time. And really, at the end of the day, I was so pleasantly surprised by how many people were excited and contributed and continue to be excited and are so motivated to do these projects and to reduce their own footprints. You know, a big part of this is the collective work that these teams are now going to do, but another big part of it is the individual level changes. So our hope is that these collaborative projects will create incentives for people to make the individual behavior changes as well. So yeah, that's what I'm looking forward to.
Thank you. And there's a question here. First, I just want to say it's wonderful to come to one of these
events
and see young people. So often it's filled with white hair, and this time it's true. Anyway, how are you going to spread this around? For example, are you going to get into people's homes, other places in the city, and try and communicate with other people, especially apartment buildings where all kinds of waste goes on all the time?
So here's what's going to happen. This is going to be an enormous success. We're going to get all kinds of national media coverage. We're going to attract foundations who want to give us all kinds of money. And we're going to develop a second stage where there are going to be 10 neighborhoods in Vancouver, perhaps, or five in Vancouver and maybe five in Toronto, and Evergreen's going to be the sponsor. And we're going to then build on this. We're going to radiate outwards. We're going to disseminate the information via a range of media, including video, earned media through print and broadcast. And we're going to get to the levels of municipal governments who are going to realize immediately that they've all got great plans, but they haven't got traction at the local level, and they really need something like Green Block. And it's just going to take off. It's going to mushroom across Canada, and we're going to reduce our footprint by 25%. Yeah. Federal government will just, they'll fall over. They'll be looking for things like this. The answer is somewhere, you know, somewhat less perhaps optimistic than that. But that's, I'm from a journalism background, and this is a good story. And it's timely, and it's got personal angles to it, and it would make for a very nice documentary. And I think it will get lots of play in media once we start going that route.
We have a question here, and then one for Michael.
My name is Melissa Chan. I'm an ecologist, and I just want to make a plug for the SFU certificate program in sustainable community development, which I did a couple years ago. Thank you both for your presentation today. Jenny, I realize there's a lot of constraints when you're doing an incredibly comprehensive study like you did. I've got a comment and a question with regards to building operations and maintenance. I realize you probably couldn't get into the whole construction side of it. So one thing that spins off for me is there's very little regulation at the private landowner stage, where we see these wonderful, almost heritage homes or well looked after homes constantly being knocked down and larger ones being built. I have asked the mayor about that. I have a comment. I won't disclose the municipality, but I looked up and I saw all the lights on, but noticed there's a lot of glass in the atrium. They have incredible sunlight flooding this city hall. So I left a very polite note at the desk wondering, was there a mechanism where these lights could go off during ample sunlight? Turns out they had the technology from 2009 that had the photovoltaic sensors. The lights should have been going off when there was ample daylight. It had been on override for 5.5 years. Now they're really excited because I actually looked up, I must have used my field biology skills. So I'm encouraging everybody to keep your eyes open and ask questions. I need to circle back to the Richmond Oval because they always have their lights on and nobody responded to my question, same thing. We can build the best state-of-the-art building, but unless people are actually operating them like they should be, it's pretty frustrating. Yeah. Thank you.
So those are great questions, and I actually have answers. So the first one on the rate of building turnover. So that's when people are tearing down a building that's not at the end of life in order to put up a bigger building to maximize the lot value, because we have been in this real boom for real estate for a very long time. So it is captured in the sense that the average life, so it's a life cycle analysis that I did on the urban metabolism, and the slide where you see the operating energy that shows the embodied energy in the materials, that's captured. The average life for a house or for a residential structure in Vancouver is 40 years. That's really low. There's no reason for us to be, and that's the average, right? So some buildings are getting turned over on lots much faster than that. Some are lasting much longer. So it is definitely a factor in the ecological footprint, and it is being captured by the materials throughput and the life cycle amortization. So if the average of the building stock was longer, as it is in the institutional and commercial buildings where we're averaging at 70 years, then it gets amortized. And so if you go back on the slide, I don't know how easy that is, but you could see that the institutional commercial stock has a much lower embodied energy than the residential stock, and it's exactly reflecting that rate of turnover. The other piece, Okay, so the 1% is the embodied energy in the commercial building stock. So one of the things that we know is that high-rise construction, cement is very energy greenhouse gas emission intensive, but tends to have a much longer lived life. Wood is definitely a sustainable building choice. The footprint biases towards, again, like paper, because there's a land area component to the harvesting of wood, so it does bias against wood, but that doesn't mean that wood's not a good material choice as well. But here what you're seeing is the incredible turnover rate in the residential stock, because we have high-rise buildings that are residential, as well as institutional buildings, right? So just wanted to clarify that. The second question, I absolutely agree. One of the things that we have been doing in the built environment, and this is really close to my heart at BCIT, we're in the School of Construction and Environment, is that we are operating in a world where we think that because energy is relatively cheap in North America, it doesn't matter if we use it. We have better things to do with our time than making sure that the sensors are working properly, etc. So there are many, many, many examples of buildings that have been intelligently designed but are not operating the way they were intended, or that people are just not turning out the lights when they walk out the door. It's as easy as flipping a switch. They're all by the door. It's very convenient, but we don't do it. So absolutely, the occupant use and operational maintenance of these buildings is essential. Another big feature that I just want to bring in while we're talking about it is we went into a phase of preference for glass curtain wall construction in Vancouver, very, very inefficient because we're choosing low-performing glass. We could be more insulating, but that's a higher upfront cost for the developer. So we're passing on, and we already are in a very high-priced building market. We're trying to build those buildings at low cost to get them into the market, but they're high cost to operate thereafter, right? So buildings with full glass curtain walls on the south exposure that overheat in the summer, no sunshading attention, got to get the air conditioners retrofitted in or manage this in some way. By the same token, in the winter, if you do a thermal imaging of these buildings, they're literally heat sticks. We're just pumping the air, hot air, out into the atmosphere. Like it's crazy what we're doing. So our mechanical systems have been evolving and becoming more and more efficient over the last 20 years, but our design and the materials we're using have become less efficient. So after 20 years of green building advocacy and leadership in Vancouver, we're actually flatlined on our per square foot or per meter squared of energy performance. And that's horrific. But the city of Vancouver is very much on top of this issue now and is going after higher performance standards. So thank you for the opportunity to talk about that.
Michael. Hi, Michael Alexander, City Conversations. Well, you've just described where I live. South-facing, glass curtain wall, medium-quality double-pane glass, but not high, not high-quality triple-pane or some of the newer technologies, and balconies, which simply radiate heat because you're heating the inside of the building, and then the balcony simply radiated out, and most of the balconies are unused all year long. I want to address a couple of things that came up. First of all, this image, which is I found really important because it, for two reasons. The first is that it shows that residential embodied energy is relatively minor, and that it's the operating energy that really matters. And yet one of the arguments when neighborhoods start to change is don't tear down that house because it has embodied energy. You hear that a lot in San Francisco now for people who are trying to keep neighborhoods exactly as they are today. What this says is that that's a relatively weak argument compared to operating energy. And you're absolutely right. Most buildings that are being built today that are built to high LEED standards simply are not being operated properly. They're operated frequently on the emergency system that's designed to cut in for the one day that the high efficiency system is being repaired, and they operate for 5 years on the emergency system because nobody knows how to work it. I'll try to be brief. The other thing to Jim is you're talking about one kind of scale, which is, and I'm a former journalist, so I appreciate this. You want to take the scale of this project, which is one block, and scale it up to the whole city and scale it up to the whole country. There's another kind of scale, though, which is the fact that you've got 23 households out of 100. And that follows the 80-20 rule in business, which is that you've got 20% of the people who are early adopters, and I think that's who you got. The other 80% are much harder to get. The final 20% of those will, in a very nice Canadian way, say very nasty things about what you're trying to do, but not to your face. How do you scale up to that other 80%?
So the answer to that is I don't know. But I'm going to guess that recycling, the norming around recycling, perhaps has a few answers to that. And that as projects like this, I mean, I'm thinking about my block. I know everybody on my block, and I think I've got a rough idea about who, if they had the time, would be part of this project and who is curious about this project and who hates this project. And I think there are roughly about 10% don't like this project at all and would like it to go away. And then there's, but everybody else is a kind of, those other folks are reachable. So ask me in 3 years.
And I just like to challenge the notion. I wouldn't draw the conclusion, the same one as you, that a blanket statement that the old building stock should come down. I think it really depends on the case. I'm a firm believer that the greenest building is the one that's already standing in most situations, and what we need to do is improve the operation of the building, the thermal performance. There's ways that you can retrofit for better performance. In some cases, for seismic or other reasons, maybe you do the best thing is to take the building down and rebuild, but I would not say that that's a blanket statement that can be deduced from the research.
So last question.
Thanks. Emmanuel from One Earth. I had a question for you, Jim, regarding the different categories, the food, the transportation, consumables, etc. Did you see some consistency between the households, or did it really vary widely? I think the pilot would have a much bigger transportation footprint. But other than that, just because it's in one neighborhood with, you know, the same kind of lots and houses, was there some consistency or not? And what were your recommendations for the construction side, the building side, to improve? Is it insulation?
So Helen, you'd probably be the best person to speak to that, because Helen saw is most keenly aware of the overall stats. I'm just going to say I think there's consistency around transportation. There's a lot of air travel in the footprints of folks on our block, and the biggest footprint on our block, I'm pretty sure, is tied to air travel, because I know that person and she shared her data with me. And I'm astonished by that. I mean, it's all air travel. And the other thing is food. So in terms around buildings, it's reduce your gas consumption.
Yeah, I would echo that statement. There was definitely a range in total amount of global hectares being used based on the number of people in the household, you know, how many people are getting around and how many people are taking flights. But in terms of ratio, definitely things were quite similar. Like everybody who ate red meat had a similar percentage of that contributing to their footprint. Everybody who flew generally had a similar, you know, air travel was always the biggest, and then car travel. So the numbers might have been different, like the totals, but the percentages were often the same, except for the outliers, like the person who had to travel monthly for business, or, you know, the family that had already gone entirely vegetarian. Aside from that, things were fairly consistent.
So a quick question. How many of you think you could do this in your own neighborhood or your student? Any of you think you could do that? You think one, two, three. So let's just put up our hands. How many of us think we could do this in our own neighborhood? Yeah. A lot of people not sure. Why is that? Just call it out.
Deniers?
Other reasons?
Don't know our neighborhood.
Yeah. Don't know our neighbor. How many of us don't know our neighborhoods? Yeah. So that alone together was our theme last year with the SFU Public Square, and 77% of us do not talk to our neighbors or have never asked for a favor of our neighbors. Astounding when you think about it. So I want to say a very big thank you to Jim and Jenny for everything that you're doing. You certainly, being a part of those dialogues, it was inspirational. And I'm getting there. I'm getting there. Look out 22nd and Commercial Street. We may be doing this soon. So thank you very, very much.
Okay.
I want to, yes.